Site. You just go to crimeandmusic.com, scroll down to the speak pipe, and just using your own phone's microphone or your laptop or your tablet or whatever, you can leave us a voicemail message, and it comes right to our email.
Yeah, use your things to do some stuff.
And if you like that, well, and it's a cool message, and it's something fun or quirky or just, you know, just anybody, we'll put you on the next episode.
Yeah, make us laugh.
So, thanks, guys. All right, coming to the stage this week. Ben doesn't know who it is.
I don't know who it is.
Since you guys clicked on the link or the episode, you know who it is, but he has no
idea. I don't know who it is. Here.
Yeah. Are you ready?
I want hints.
You want
and
hints?
For any of our audience listening along that maybe is driving along, they just played the next episode.
I'm trying.
They might not know who it is either, so we're going to play a game.
It's true. We'll play it together.
All right. How many hints do you want to give me?
I'm going to give you 3 strikes. I'm a classic American baseballer. 3 strikes and you're out.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Hint number one.
Hint number one.
It's a guy.
Okay. We've narrowed it down to 50% of the population.
I mean, kind of roughly. Let's not get into that.
A dude. We got a dude.
Gentleman.
A gentleman. Was that the second one?
Nah, it's a tip on the guy. It's a gentleman.
He's a gentleman.
He's a gentleman.
All right, now I feel like it might not be like modern time dude. All right. Go ahead. Number two. Number two. I'm ready.
Was it Woodstock?
Was at Woodstock. Okay, that's a good tip. That's a good one. I mean, I know a lot of the different musicians that were at Woodstock.
Right.
I love this. I love this time period, too, so I'm pretty excited.
Oh, good.
I'm excited. I like this. Yeah. All right. Was it Woodstock? I get one more guess. Yep. One more tip, and then I get to render a guess.
Yep.
All right. Go ahead.
Astronomy.
I don't know.
So, he's a gentleman.
He's a gentleman.
Was it Woodstock?
Is he English?
He is.
I still don't know.
Ready? Did you just want me to tell you? I'm going to gamble on this one. This is like going red or black on the roulette wheel. He's a drummer.
He's a drummer. He is... English. Well, that was a freebie.
That was a freebie.
Oh, man. Ron Wood?
No.
Was Ron Wood a drummer?
I don't know. That's why I said no.
Who's the drummer for The Who?
His name is Keith Moon.
Keith Moon! I met Keith Moon!
You were so close.
I meant to say Keith Moon in my head.
You were out, sir. That's Keith 4 Moon. Strikes. 3 strikes, foul tip, and...
I guess you're going to miss Moon.
big whiff on
that. I'm excited for Keith Moon. There's a thing in our thing. We know stuff about Keith Moon here in Flint, Michigan, don't we?
We do.
We do.
We'll get there.
All right.
August 23rd, 1946. Keith John Moon was born at Central Middlesex Hospital in northwestern London.
I'm still surprised that some of our people we do things about, their last names.
Moon?
Moon! That doesn't seem like a real last name to me.
That's a real last
That's
name?
That's his last name.
That's his last
name. I mean, Bieber didn't sound like a last name. Our last episode.
Yeah, Bobby A. No, yeah.
I'm surprised sometimes. Sometimes it's not. Sometimes it is.
I like it. I like that you're surprised.
Yeah, Keith Moon.
Ben was bending over to pick up a beer.
A 7-Up. And, hey, by the way, we got some surprises coming up in this episode, Brian told me. He's got some, like, underhanded things he's going to do.
It's a fun performance, as always, my friend.
I got things.
I got stuff. I got tricks.
Seriously.
You're ready for Keith Moon?
No, I got stuff for Keith Moon.
I had to tell our preview editor, I spoke to him on the phone last night, to not tell you, and he was like, don't even tell me then, because I don't want it. So I didn't want to ruin it for either of you.
Unbelievably, I got stuff for Keith Moon.
Bieber was a mega episode 10, but Keith Moon's got a fat stack of cards himself. So, Keith Moon, Keith John Moon, what'd we say, August 23rd, 1946, born to parents Alfred Charles, Elf, and Kathleen Winifred, Kit, Elf and Kit Moon.
So he was born, like, at the beginning of the baby boomer. Baby boomers over in the Britons?
I guess so.
I mean, for the same reason we did. Everybody came back from war.
We do have a couple of English listeners.
And
please
bang.
Let us know if you guys are called the baby boomers. I don't know if that's a global term or just the U.S.
I feel like the nature of the history was just that, hey, everybody comes back from war a little bit. And what's the first thing you want to do?
Get it on.
Well, you want to have a nice steak first, and then you want to get it on.
Let's
and then the third
on.
Thing is nap time.
So let me tell you a little bit about... Keith grew up in Wembley. No, well, I'm sure he did. We'll get there. Keith grew up in Wembley, an area of northwest London, England, part of the London borough of Brent.
And a very big area for music.
Well, originally it was just a village on a hill by a clearing with
they built
Harrow Road south of it.
They built a stadium, didn't they? Wembley?
Yeah, give a second here, buddy. I know, you're excited. I'm excited. So, in 1547, there's only 6 houses in Wembley. They're small, but they're real wealthy. And they've got Wembley Stadium. They've got the London Eye. And it's an important center of, like, South Asian jewelry and gold shops.
Of course it is.
Attracting people from as far as Lancaster, which is, like, 100 miles away. The London Eye is that big Ferris wheel.
Oh, that's in Wembley?
Yeah.
Oh.
So, you know where you're at.
I thought it was in London.
No. It's in Wembley. Right. Which is part of northwest London.
Brent. Is it like a borough, you think?
Kinda, right. You know. Right. Manhattan, so. Notable residents of Wembley. John Lingwood. He's the drummer for Manfred Mann's Earth Band.
Oh, another drummer.
Yeah. Charlie Watts, drummer for the Rolling Stones.
Really?
Yeah. And Maxine Nightingale. She's a singer, like a soul record.
I'm sure she drummed a little bit in her day, though.
She drummed.
Yeah.
So his dad, Alf, was a maintenance mechanic, and his mom, Kit, was a cleaner.
She cleaned.
My mom. September 1951, he goes to, he studies at local primary school, Barham. That's foreshadowing.
Barham.
Well, either way, bars and drums, not what Keith needs. Keith was a hyperactive kid. We would call it ADHD, but back then they're just like, he's hyperactive.
He's a boy.
He was super imaginative. He watched a little radio show. He listened to a radio show. I get confused because it's like he's super imaginative, but his favorite thing to do was like listen to a radio show.
Well, it took imagination.
I suppose.
Yeah.
He listened to a thing he loved. It was called The Goon Show.
The Goon Show.
The Goon Show is a British radio comedy broadcast by the BBC Home Service from 1951 to 1960. And they had, like, crazy stories and catchphrases and puns and stuff and weird sound effects. Like, Saturday Night Live of British radio in the 50s, you know?
Like, what kind of sound effects, Brian?
We'll get that.
Did they have any, like, drum sound effects?
They probably did.
Like, what kind of drum sound effects?
bass drum. I don't know what.
What's your favorite drum to hit as a drummer, Brian? I mean, when you got, if you only got one thing to hit, what would you hit, Brian?
I don't know. The snare drum.
All right, that's a good answer.
What is your answer? What would you?
I'll have to think about it. All right. Ask me a little bit.
I'll ask you in a little bit. They did. They had bizarre sound effects. The funny stuff. It's like these are the people who influenced Monty Python.
Right, and this is the drummer episode, so we're going to keep it focused on
all drums. Okay.
All drum episodes.
It's the Goon Show. They had a couple running gags. These ones I thought were funny. They had are you familiar with the rhubarb gag? Do you understand that?
Mm-mm.
Rhubarb. Back in the old days of radio and stuff, like in the 20s and 30s, they would create the crowd effect in the background.
Yeah.
Having large groups of people repeat rhubarb. So it's like 30, like 30,
so
40.
Like murmur.
Right, and it sounds like a bunch of people. On the Goon Show, they had three people doing it.
So you can clearly hear the rhubarb.
They would over enunciate the word rhubarb too.
Rhubarb!
Rhubarb! Rhubarb! And then they had this other bit called Trapped in a Piano, where a guy would end up trapped in a piano. And Everett's like, I'm trapped in a piano.
Excuse me.
I'm trapped in a piano. So,
see, this is English humor.
Right.
I appreciate English humor big time.
This is Keith Moon's favorite show. Here, I actually have a clip of the Goon Show you can listen to here.
Oh.
Check this out.
Have a Shinji's thing. Why are the men mutinying?
Indeed, sir. There is a nasty rumor that the cartridges for their rifles are being greased with banana skins.
Well, sir, the natives look upon the banana as a sacred animal.
Hot?
What a
rattle me crowd is there. That's a lot of thank you. Just time for a that's a lot of superstitious nonsense. The banana's a non-sacred animal.
Nevertheless, sir, the native troops are in flame.
Well, we all are. It's adobe itch, you know. It's nothing. Don't drink castor oil.
Are you mad, Major?
What?
The natives regard castor oil as a sacred animal. I'm only a simple Englishman, and I know that.
You're simpler than I thought.
And so saying, he pointed to a map of Delhi where Major Brudnock was preparing to do battle.
There you go. That's
so
the Goon Show.
That's the Goon Show in like the 1960s?
1950s, man. 1951 to 1960.
Okay.
And
okay.
So now I was able to play that clip because it's old enough to where
copyright
and public domain comes in. So.
I don't like that. I want more clips. I really like that. I like that part of that.
I know.
This show.
I know. Now we can do that. Then.
I know. I want to have like interactive things for our listeners. I want to hear things. I want to say things. I'll play some music.
Oh, yeah.
We need everybody to go to Patreon and give us millions of dollars.
Millions.
Some of the best dollars, really. And so we can like
do these things.
Buy a little bit of music and then put it on here.
Yeah, sure.
But to really give the whole entire sense of what we're talking about with Keith Moon. I feel like he's a multimedia genius.
He was good.
He's a good driver.
1958, age 12, Keith joins the Sea Cadet Corps Band. It's kind of similar to like the Scouts or like a police cadet sort of thing. Like, you know, they had the similar value and ethos to the Royal Navy. That was what they were sort of.
Probably had a uniform.
Right.
And he was in the band.
He was. He played the bugle, which, if you don't know, it's a trumpet without the buttons or valves. It's just like a bugle.
Yeah. It's a tube bent around.
Yeah. So, Keith attended Alperton Secondary Modern School.
Yeah.
And he failed his 11-plus exams, which stopped him from attending grammar school. So if you're from England, please explain that to me, because I looked. It's basically like he made it through high school, but he wasn't smart enough to go to college.
No,
I was going to say, it's got to be middle school.
You got my grade 8, eh?
Correct. Now, this is a quote from his art teacher. In a report, she wrote, retarded artistically, idiotic in other respects.
That is so... Please repeat.
His art teacher said in a report, retarded artistically, idiotic in other respects.
That's high praise in my world.
Well, his music teacher wrote, he has great ability, but must guard against the tendency to show off.
Yeah, I think I had that written on the back of my report card once or twice.
The ADHD kids, man. We all would have got it, dude.
Everyone.
Every single one of us would have been labeled ADD or ADHD.
You know the
you
one
know
I had?
It.
I had the most. This is the worst too, because it's like it's so shaming. It's not even saying this kid's just a jackass idiot. No hope.
No,
has potential. Has great potential.
I had so much potential.
Every one of my teachers was like, shows potential.
Well, look at you now.
I still find the potential.
Me too.
No, I haven't spent that potential. Still got it.
Still banking on that, baby. That's retirement potential right there.
One day we'll realize my potential.
Someday.
Yeah, so, today.
Well, much like yourself, Keith thought the bugle was too hard. So he took up the drums instead. So on his way home from school, he'd stop at McCary's music studio and practice the drums there. Because, you know, drums are kind of an investment. That's a big thing.
Drums are fun.
Yeah.
So your favorite one was a snare.
I guess so, yeah. Like snare drum. I mean, if I only got one, I would play the snare drum. Why?
That's a good answer.
Oh, God. What have you done?
That's a good answer.
What would you play, Ben?
It's not wrong. Keep it wrong.
Or cowbell.
You and your fucking fancy sound effects. This is a real cowbell right
That's
here.
That's a real cowbell. Ben is taken from my drum set.
And notice the cowbell in the corner. Not being used. Which is the 11th commandment. Thou shalt not play a cowbell.
We're not actually blowing the limits either. That's not bad.
I learned this in one day. Don't fear the Reaper. I
blew oyster cult. The BOC. That's not.
Hey,
did you detach that?
I didn't take the whole fucking drum set out of here, dude.
Oh, God.
I think with the wing nut, Brian, even you with your limited potential can figure out the wing nut part.
All right, wing nut.
Hey, I don't think this cowbell is the standard size.
It is standard size.
I don't think it is.
It's a drum set cowbell. It probably is a little smaller. It's like a 3/4.
Can we get the whole drum set in here for me?
No, we can just take the mics over there.
No,
this
how about
to a
can
laptop.
I just get that?
What are you going to do with that?
Hit it with the stick.
During the episode?
Probably.
Why?
People need to hear this.
They do not. We'll let the people decide.
Or leave those right there.
Oh, that's intimidating. Okay, are you good with that?
Just in case we need...
It might come back again.
More cowbell.
The rules to the drinking game.
I grabbed this cowbell. I did not know we were doing a drummer today.
Oh, yeah.
And so I grabbed the cowbell. I was just like, I'm going to annoy everybody with this later. And then and then it was Keith Moon. I was very excited.
I like that you have forethought in the episodes.
Do you know how hard it was for me to go this far without playing the cowbell?
It's pretty good. I mean, we're a solid 15 in this.
Come in. Hi, my friend, Ben Ruppel. That's how I want to do it now.
Oh, no, we're going to hide and lock that room next time.
All right, cowbell, go ahead.
No, cowbell's fine. Keith had hobbies like that, cowbells and drums. He liked practical jokes, and he is a big fan of the home science kit, and especially explosions. He leaves school early, around Easter, 1961. Keith is 14. He enrolls at Harrow Technical College. That led to a job as a radio repairman, and now he's got some money coming in, so Keith buys himself a drum set. I heard it said also that his mom bought him his first drum set, so whichever way you believe, Keith got a drum set, and he's 16.
And Harrow?
Harrow.
I wonder, are you a fan of that show The Office?
I'm familiar with it.
They had the English version.
Ricky Gervais.
Were they in Harrow? Was that the town name?
Heathrow.
They were not Heathrow.
There's an airport in Heathrow.
Yeah.
It's all I know.
No, I think they're in Harrow on Slough Street.
All right. I believe Harrow. Well, it comes back to Harrow because it talks about the road. I talked about the road and the Asian jewelry and gold sales.
There were six houses. They're small, but...
Oh, that was in 1547. Now they do more.
Oh, 15. Okay.
Yeah, 1540. That was a long time ago. Now it's huge. It's part
really
of London. Part of London. So, 1962. Age 16, Keith joins The Escorts. It's a band. Replacing his best friend, Jerry Evans, on the drums.
That doesn't sound very nice.
Well, no.
Maybe Jerry had to go get like a job working. What do they do in England?
Umbrellas.
He had to go get a job making motherfucking umbrellas.
So, December 1962, Keith joins a band called The Beachcombers. Mm-hmm. It's a semi-pro London cover band. And Keith starts working in, like, antics into the show, like, shooting the singer, like, a starter pistol and, like, dicking around and stuff. Keith was a big fan of beach music. He loved beach music, like the Beach Boys and surf guitar and stuff like that. He would have left them in a heartbeat to join the
so
Beach Boys.
So, like, lively, foreshadowing, you know, fun, sort of not
dark. No, upbeat, sort of good time. Good time. Fun guy. Hey.
We're going to play some instruments and have some fun.
Yeah.
And,
like Uncle Jesse and Joey Gladstone together in one guy. Cut it out. So that's Keith, he's 16. The Beachcombers all had day jobs. And so I saw a bumper sticker a long time ago when I was, like, quote-unquote, a working musician, which to me just meant I could play at bars on the weekends and make enough money to have beer on the weekends. So, but, yeah, the bumper sticker said, real musicians have day jobs. And I'm like, that's a complete and utter lie. If you're a good enough musician, you don't have to have a day job. You have a night job, and you're good. You don't need to work. But Keith worked. He's a sales guy for a British gypsum. That's the world's largest manufacturer of plasterboard. He sold plasterboard.
He's all drywall here.
Right.
He's doing?
Yeah, it's the same concept.
The world's largest?
World's largest.
Ooh.
British gypsum. So, he's 16, too. Well.
What's he doing? He's selling it?
Yeah, he's a salesman. Hey, would you like some plasterboard?
No.
Oh, all right.
You want the next place?
You want some plasterboard? April 1964, 17-year-old Keith auditions for The Who.
The what?
We'll get there. To replace Doug Sandham. Now, Doug was the original drummer for The Who, and he was a bricklayer. And most of the band members at that point in time, like Keith, were in their late teens. And
What was the drummer's name?
Doug Sandham. Doug was in his 30s.
Do you think he's hanging out with John Rutsey right now?
Oh, dude. I don't know who John Rutsey is.
To any of our listeners that can tell us who John Rutsey is.
Crime and Disease.
I think John Rutsey passed away here recently.
He is. Yeah, I'm sad. So,
maybe he did.
So Keith comes in to replace Doug, who was in his 30s, and his wife didn't like him hanging around a bunch of teenage kids. And so Keith's audition. Keith was at a show shortly after Doug left. They were using a session drummer, just like a hired gun, to come in and play. And Keith walks in there, and he's dressed completely from head to toe in what they call ginger clothes, like red, I guess. And he dyed his hair ginger. And Pete Townsend, the guitar player, called him a ginger vision and said, Keith's like, dude, I can play better than that guy. And so,
could he?
Well, they said, go ahead. And Keith played the second half. And Keith said, quote, about the whole thing. I'm gonna read you exactly what was written in the source I had. So this is an English accent, but it's in writing, so it's not.
And this is a quote from who?
Keith Moon.
Keith Moon. Was he playing cowbell at the time?
Yeah, probably. I mean, we'll get to his drumming. Quote, they said, go ahead. And I got behind the other guy's drums and several drinks to get me courage up. And when I got on stage, I went, aah! On the drums, broke off the bass drum pedal, two skins, and got off.
Got off?
It literally said off. O-F. Off. Well, and
left.
Just went ape shit on the drum. And left. It continues, quote, I figured it was it. I was scared to death. After, I was sitting at the bar, and Pete came over, he said, you, come here. I said, mild as a piece, yes. Roger Daltrey, singer. What are you doing Monday? Nothing. There's a gig Monday. If you want it, come. We'll pick you up in the van. And that was it.
There it is.
So Keith would say, I never was formally invited to join The Who permanently. And when Ringo Starr, drummer of the Beatles, asked how he joined, Keith said, just been filling in for the last 15 years.
I like your impressions, Brian.
Thank you. I'm trying.
Did you practice that?
No. It's just all natural.
Oh, that's pretty good.
Thank you. I like that. All right. Keith Moon is in The Who, which consists of John Entwistle. He plays the bass. Peter Townsend plays the guitar and does some vocals, and Roger Daltrey, the lead singer. They are considered one of the most influential rock bands of all time, selling over 100 million records worldwide.
I mean, to respect The Who here, I don't think you actually had to say that.
Well,
I mean, no matter where you're from,
you know who The Who is?
You know who the effing Who is.
All right.
Right?
We're going to try and do this. We're going to try and do this real quick here and see if we can make this happen.
What do we got?
I'm going to try and see. This had to have been a conversation that at one point took place between two people watching The Who.
What?
Can you tell me the name of the group on stage, please?
I feel like this is... Who?
Yeah, the name of the group on stage.
Who?
There's a bunch of guys up there playing instruments. I just want to know the name of them.
Who?
Yeah, that's what I'm asking you. I need to know the name of the group on stage, please.
Who?
I'm going to try this a different way. Do you know the name of the group on stage?
Yes.
Okay, so if I were to ask you the name of the group on stage, you'd be able to tell me?
Absolutely.
Okay, so if I were to say the band's name, you'd be able to tell me correctly what their name is.
Yes, I know them.
Okay, I think I got this now. Is the name of the band Yes?
No, Brian, Yes isn't here today.
I'm getting confused by this. Okay. Do you see the group on stage?
Yeah.
The name of the band. Do you know what it is?
Absolutely.
Okay. The band on stage.
No, I don't see the band. It's a different group
entirely. Okay. I'm having a hard time with this, so I'm just going to let it go. Thank you, Aunt Slappy. And see you.
What's a skit? We did a skit. We did a skit, a little skit. Brian,
nice job. That
Brian
was
a little
job.
Skit wrote now. Nice we did it together. Good it was a skit.
Job. So that's the who.
He pointed at things like I was a horse and I was supposed to stomp my feet.
Stomp your feet three times and play with the fish wire, Mr. Ed.
Say the words. It was like a who's in phrase.
I feel like I'm Phil Spector. Play the drums. It's the who. They have songs like I Can't Explain, My Generation, the rock opera, Tommy, the Pinball Wizard. Won't Get Fooled Again, Quadrophenia.
Don't.
Who are you?
The Who.
That's, well, this is The Who.
No, what was it when there?
There's The.
The?
The
wasn't
the.
There a I didn't want to bring that in.
They are The Who.
What about, no, they're just The Who.
Correct, The Who. They're not just The Who, that's Dr. Seuss's Who.
No, there was another band called, like, The Who. They were just W-H-O. Then there was another one that's T-H-E space W-H-O, wasn't there?
No. You are misinformed. That means bright line phone comes in. The Who, if you really are kind of new on your 70s and 60s rock, The Who are the people who sing the NCIS theme. Dun, 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 dun. Who are you? Who are you? Now, I didn't know this. You're not paying attention.
No,
I'm just going to keep going on. But The Who actually gave us a couple cool things. They gave us the windmill strum on guitar.
Maybe you're thinking of the band.
You got the windmill strum on the guitar.
Yeah, that was a thing.
They gave us the power cord. That's
really?
Something that The Who invented. Yep. So if you know the power cord, thank The Who. Wearing a flag is clothes. They also gave us...
Wearing a flag is clothes.
Yeah, nobody did that before The Who.
But in the music industry.
Well, just in general.
Oh, people probably fucking wore the flag somewhere.
No.
A flag.
No. Just The Who. It's The Who, dude.
I don't know. I think I saw a picture of Abraham Lincoln once wearing the flag while he's riding the Tyrannosaurus Rex down the road in Washington.
That's the one with the machine guns and the lasers.
Yeah.
They also invented the auto-destructive art movement. So I don't know if you know
erotic, erotic destruct what?
No, auto-destructive.
Auto-erotic.
Auto, sure.
No, what was that? What is auto-destructive?
It's auto-destructive. It's like where you know that they're going to just smash everything. Like, there's art, and then you destroy the art. Like so. Now, to be topical, are you familiar with who Banksy is?
No. Who?
Banksy. He's, like, an artist. He makes a lot of weird street graffiti and does, like, very large, fun things. Man, I don't even know how to do it. He, like, had ducks. He, like, randomly paint ducks on things and stencils and say, anyway.
Is he the one that, like, would hide stuff around the city and
correct.
People didn't know who it was?
Right.
That's like, all the same thing.
Right.
Yeah.
Actually, wow, we'll get there because he used to be, the real Banksy used to be a singer in a band.
Oh,
we can do Banksy! Who? So, anyway, Banksy had this piece of art. It's called The Girl with the Balloon. And he had it at that auction at Sotheby's. Like, I don't know if he had it up. He's
just
very,
recently.
He's very
the red
correct.
Thing.
Right. Did you see what happened? It sold for, like, $4.2 million, and as soon as the gavel went down to, like, end the sale, it had a shredder built into the frame, and it went...
No, I saw the article. I didn't care enough to, like, get into it.
Right. Well, I just remembered Banksy was revealed to be some, like, mod punk singer or something like that from some bank. We'll get there.
We will. So the people that bought that thing didn't know it was going to happen?
Oh, no. Yeah, they said there must have been a Banksy employee with a remote at the auction, and as soon as it sold, they were supposed to, like, hit the button, and then it only shredded, like, 3/4 of it. There's still, like, a strip at the top and all the things hanging out at the bottom of it. Look it up when you get done here. It's great.
Huh. So. That's great. I like that stuff.
Right. Oh, and let me think here. They also gave us feedback, too. So using feedback in songs, The Who gave us that.
I hate that sound. Gosh, I wish you would hate it. I just stopped playing that button anymore, Brian.
I thought you liked all of them.
I like the buttons. I like the little buttons that we got, but not that one. That hurts my soul.
So you asked about auto-destructive art.
Okay, so that's guys smashing guitars and shit.
Right. At a show.
They were really like the first ones to do that?
At a show at the Railway Tavern in Harrow, Pete smashed his guitar after accidentally breaking it. And then the audience demanded he do it again. And then Keith Moon was looking at him, are we doing this? You know, he gave him a look. He's like, yeah, we doing this. And then so Keith kicks over the drums. And
they just tore it up.
They do it after every show now. And since then, it's been described as auto-destructive art.
Well, now, they were also maybe on the head. Didn't they? Like, they, like, crash rooms and shit. We'll get there. I mean, that's got to be part of it, too. Like, hey, guys, I want to go to bed now. Oh, we got to trash the room.
You're getting way ahead of yourself here, buddy. He's back there. Pete said, quote, a set of skins is about, well, okay, $300, because I don't know the British equivalent. And after every show, we'd go bang, 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 kick the whole thing over. And so, bang, 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 I imagine, is when he's just stabbing the drum skins, like, because a drum skin is like a tight plastic sort of thing.
Part you hit.
But if you stab it, your drumstick will go through it. So,
yeah.
Premier drum executive, those are the guys who supplied Keith Moon with his drums, Eddie Haynes. He claimed that Keith carefully kicked over his drum kit and it rarely needed repairs, except for, like, stands and foot pedals. Quote, he would go through them like a hot knife through butter. So, like, the bass drum pedal, he'd break that shit all the time. And, like, the cymbal stands, those all break and stuff. So,
but
the rest of it stayed.
But not the expensive part.
Yeah, the actual drum shells.
Because they may have not been making that much money then.
Right.
Because at a point, then, they were taking a, you know, they'd buy a guitar for, let's just say, $400 or $500.
Right.
Wreck the shit out of it. And probably make that guitar then worth $1,000.
$1,000
in pieces. And another one. I mean.
This is well before eBay and all that shit, too. I mean, this is, like, real stuff.
I know a dude that's got some memorabilia like that.
Some pieces. Yeah. Some shards.
Yeah, he's, I mean, more from the punk stuff, but
they did it, too. That's cool. Well, 1965, a hobby is born. Keith buys a case of 500 cherry bombs. He quickly developed a reputation for destroying bathrooms and blowing up toilets. So, and then he moves from cherry bombs to M80s to sticks of dynamite.
Oh, wow.
Which became his explosive of choice.
All
that porcelain flying through the air is quite unforgettable. I'd never realized dynamite was so powerful. I'd used penny bangers before.
Penny bangers?
That's what he said.
Aren't those sausages?
I would think so, right? Exploding.
Penny bangers and mash?
Sounds like. So Pete Townsend walked into Moon's hotel room in the bathroom, like only the S bend was hanging out of the wall.
Where's this at?
Just anywhere. And he said since the cherry bomb was about to explode, he had to throw it down the loo. And so.
That's how he learned how to do that?
Right. And Keith showed Pete the case of cherry bombs, and Pete said, we got thrown out of every hotel we ever stayed in.
So we did. That.
All right. Alabama, Keith and Entwistle, the bass player, loaded a toilet with cherry bombs after being denied room service. Quote, this is from Entwistle, I believe. The toilet was just dust over the walls by the time we checked out. The manager brought down our suitcases to the gig and said, don't come back.
So they're just blowing fucking toilets up, left and right.
The hotel manager calls Keith's room one time to tell him to turn down the noise. Keith asks him up to the room, excuses himself for a second when the guy's at the door, puts a lit stick of dynamite in the toilet, shuts the bathroom door, and he goes to the manager. Wait, you're saying? After the explosion, Keith turns the music back on and says, quote, dear boy, that was noise. This is the ooh!
So they were just wrecking shit. I like that, though. Do you think they're doing that for publicity, or are they...
No,
kind of blazing trails.
No.
It gave them publicity.
Yeah, correct. People didn't know to do that before these guys.
They were just doing
this is the thing.
They weren't spitting in anybody's faces.
Well, here, I'll spoil some fun for you. March 17th, 1966, Keith marries Kim Kerrigan. 3 months later, daughter Amanda is born. The press didn't find out about the marriage or the baby until 1 year later.
Oh, so they kept it.
Yeah. They hit it up.
All right. So they knew it was something.
Yeah. April 1967, The Who appear on the Smothers Brothers Comedy Hour.
Yeah, do I get to hear a Smothers Brothers interpretation here, Brian?
I was trying to figure out my brother, you know, like the whole thing, and I didn't know how to do it without having you in on the gag.
The Smothers Brothers, they didn't have distinct voices.
Tommy, I thought, was kind of like the, I don't know, not a distinct voice, but I guess I could pick it out.
Well, was he ever on the Ed Sullivan Show, Brian?
No. Very big dream, really.
I bet they were.
So, Keith bribes a stagehand to load gunpowder into the bass drum, but the stagehand's like, who's Keith Loon? So he uses 10 times the amount of gunpowder that Keith and he talked about. And so during the final of My Generation, talking about my generation, Keith kicks the drums off the riser and sets off the dynamite, and the intensity of the blast singes most of Pete's hair and embeds a piece of cymbal in Keith's arm and blew the rest of the band off stage, blinded two cameras and fellow guests, Betty Davis. She also fainted.
Is that where Betty Davis' eyes came from?
Oh, my God. I bet you that is. Blew your mind, man. You did just blow my mind because I've been researching the crap out of this, and that's
so Betty Davis. So I wonder, that just gunpowder, if you just light gunpowder, like a pile of gunpowder, it just goes. It doesn't go bang.
Combustion. Right.
You need to have it under pressure. It needs to be like contained in a cylinder of some kind, like a grenade or whatever.
Yeah, encapsulated.
So it'll still, you get enough, it'll displace some air.
Oh,
that's
yeah.
Probably and what happened.
That's
it's just
enclosed
like a
in the bass drum, so it's a tight sort of, I mean, it could
that's
be tightly packed.
But it probably packed it full. Boom. It didn't do like
boosh.
It didn't do a pop.
No, it's probably more of a concussive
and
thing.
A lot of fire.
Like a blast and then a shot.
That's small, yeah, like too. We let some gunpowder on fire last night.
What were you doing?
I don't do this regularly.
Making some coffee.
No, we were hanging out at Adam's house, and Ryan was over there, and me and Adam and Ryan were playing darts or something. Well, maybe before Ryan got there. And Adam just got some old guns from his dad, who passed away here recently, some old, like, muzzleloader guns.
Oh, wow.
Dump gunpowder down the barrel and then put the bullets down there.
Ball and wad and stuff.
So he had this bullhorn, like a horn of a bull, that was turned into a gunpowder thing, you know, where you, like,
oh God,
like Looney Tunes started looking shit.
Yeah, man.
And so,
Davy Crockett.
So, Davy Crockett. So, it's hanging up on the wall, and we're out in the wood shop, which is, you know, the manly room, and then back in the barn, in his yard,
detached garage.
So, I took the gun, and I opened it, and dumped on the table. Whoa, there's gunpowder in here. Cool. So, I got a little pile going on the floor, and, it on fire.
Now, that dovetails nicely into how they would proof alcohol, because they would take a bit of gunpowder, pour your homemade hooch on it, and then light it, and if it was enough to ignite the gunpowder, your alcohol is considered proofed.
If it didn't ignite, it wouldn't. It was bad.
Yeah, that's not high enough proof alcohol. Yeah. They watered it down for you. So
it lit on fire. It made this nice smell. It smelled like firecrackers, like fireworks.
I do like fireworks.
Yeah, I like that smell. It's a good smell.
Well, since we got off onto a weird tangent, we're going to take a break right now. And when we come back, Moon. Your break.
I didn't get any snacks.
We don't actually have a lot of snacks around here.
No, I'm bringing snacks next time. But everybody, I just like to let you know, Brian's a dick.
Oh, good.
He won't let me eat snacks on here.
You can't eat on the microphone.
What if they're gummy bears?
No. People hate that. There's an actual thing where it's like the sound of people chewing is like a like if your wife's listening right now, like I say, moist. And a bunch of people are like, come on, man.
And panties. Filling panties.
Moist panties is the worst.
I love moist.
And so if you hear like the same type of reaction, like a nails on a chalkboard.
People
chewing.
Okay.
I hate that sound.
Backstory, everybody. So Brian and I are doing these episodes. And as much as everybody like to think we like recorded this earlier this morning from you listening to it, no, we're like, hey, we got to start doing them a little bit more professionally here.
Quote unquote. We're like 2 months ahead, I'll tell people.
No, yeah. So we decided, hey, let's try to do two at a time because Brian and I live a little ways away, so it takes a little time to get to, you know, together and schedule and all that crap. So we did two episodes. I'm trying to make a case for me able to have snacks. I think I need a snack.
If the people vote and say you can have a snack, I will allow you to have snacks.
Okay. So make your people vote yes.
Make your plea to your MySpace friends.
It will happen. So I think I should be able to have a snack, even if you have to hear me kind of eating it a little bit on the air. But you can vote on what snack I get. Just a little bit about myself. I like salty over sweet, but I'm not opposed to having some like a chocolate. You know, I like chocolate. But for a snack,
it's a snack or a dating profile.
No, maybe both. I would like maybe some potato chips. Not the Pringles though.
No, Pringles are some weird concoction.
The only time I ever eat Pringles is when I'm with my friend Ryan. He makes me eat Pringles.
No full names.
Why?
Because he can sue us technically.
Well, he has so many reasons he could probably sue me before this episode.
It's true. He's a member of the crew on the show.
But when he eats a Pringle,
he's our preview editor.
This is how he eats it. I need something.
Need a Pringle?
This is how he eats his Pringle. He'll take one out, like, daintily off the pile of Pringles. He'll just take that Pringle out of the stack. And then he slowly, like, opens his mouth as wide as it'll go. And then places the Pringle on his tongue. And then slowly collapses and crushes that Pringle. And then he gets this, like, look on his face of, like, satisfaction.
Now it's gotta
be. And then he'll look around a little bit to see who's watching him eat that Pringle. And he does it again. How many Pringles do you think are in a can? Like, 150?
Probably.
150 times.
Does he one do at a time. Curbside up or curbside down? Like, is it matching the shape of his tongue?
Well, it goes both ways, though.
Well, depending on the point of
reference. It goes this way, and it goes this way. And if you flip it over, then it goes the other way in the other
way. I used to know the name of that shape, like a dihedral parabola or something.
It's a fucking Pringle shape.
It's a Pringle shape. It's a saddle.
Yeah, it's a saddle. So, okay. I'll eat a Pringle, though.
That's good to know.
But I like Better Made potato chips. Can we say that?
I do like Better Made potato chips. They're not a sponsor, but that's a Michigan Detroit company that makes
barbecue ones. All of them are good. I celebrate their entire catalog.
I just bought some white cheddar popcorn last night, trying to be healthy.
Are you serious?
Yeah, it's up there.
We got white cheddar popcorn in my house for the first time since I remember living. My wife bought it for the kids. They picked that white cheddar popcorn.
Yeah, people love it. That Boom Chicka Pop, not a sponsor.
I put it in
all that stuff.
I put it in their lunches. They like.
Do you not like it? No.
I like
white cheddar's good.
But if I'm gonna open a bag of something, I want like a potato chip. I want something hard. I can make popcorn.
You remember they used to make thick chips?
Thick chips?
Thick. They were not the actual name brand, but the actual chip was like thicker than normal. Like that
thick
was a thing.
Chips.
Right. They were like I don't know, home style or whatever you want to call them, but they were like thicker. It was like back in the late 80s, early 90s. O'Grady's, O'Gratin, that was a good one. That was like a...
Well, now
they
call it the kettle chips that are kind of really
crunchy. No. That's really crunchy, but they're actually like a thicker cut. They weren't as thin as like a regular potato chip. They
like the Lay's potato. Well, they got the like ruffles and they have ridges.
Right, but they were like thick ridges.
You know, like the
I like them thick.
What are the Cheetos? Not Cheetos.
Scoops?
The scoops, what are they? Fritos.
Fritos. Oh,
Fritos are like just really thick corn chips.
Fritos are actually kind of good for you. There's like four ingredients. I mean, a lot of it's oil and
stuff. Salt.
Those are not honestly necessarily bad for you. They really aren't.
The whole thing.
Heart disease and stuff like that is and high blood pressure is honestly like 80-some% genetic. So
it's no reason to even worry about that.
Low-fat diet. They did a British study over 50 years. No effect on anyone's weight or overall health.
All right.
Fat, no fat.
Keith Moon.
Well, they called him Moon the Loon. So,
you can get in trouble for fucking around the moon here.
Don't fuck around loons.
Don't. You'll not only get in trouble, people will come after your shit.
A loon is a duck with a thin, pointy bill.
Not a duck, it's a waterfowl.
Yeah, okay. A loon is a duck with a thin, pointy bill. We've been having the conversation if it's a loon or a duck since
they
like sixth grade. Good for them.
Yeah, and they live to be like a dozen years old. They come back to the same lake all the time. They migrate.
Easy hunting.
No, you can't hunt them. You can't even go buy them in a boat. You'll get in trouble.
Are there not a lot of loons? What's
no, there's not. There's not a lot of loons.
Why?
Because you're dumb animals.
Exactly. So, Moon the Loon, Keith Moon the Loon, they called him that because he's a prankster. And, you know, he liked to
blow up toilets.
Well, he blew up toilets. And his humor sometimes rubbed people the wrong way. For instance, he would dress up in a Nazi officer uniform and drive through Jewish neighborhoods, throwing a Sieg Heil every once in a while along the way.
Do that today, much less then, dude.
In the 60s, yeah. He once put a barbecued pig's head in Barry Whitnam, drummer for Herman Hermits, in his bed.
That's funny. I mean, that's fine. It's not offensive.
He also liked to put fake spiders between the sheets.
That's funny.
A barbecued pig's head's not offensive?
Dude, you know how hard that would be to do?
To barbecue it? That'd take a good couple 10 hours.
Yeah, I mean, that's dedication.
I'm sure he bought it barbecued. On tour with the herd, Keith put firecrackers in the piano, and he rigged a pulley system on the gong used by their drummer. Every time he tried to hit the gong, it would move back just slightly enough out of his reach where he couldn't hit it. I thought that was awesome.
It's so funny. I mean, the gong is like the big...
Oh, that's the finale.
It's the... Yeah, and then everybody expected it, and then
he's like, no, no.
He can't hit
just
it.
Out of reach. So,
nothing sadder than someone who can't hit the gong.
Yep. All right. I think this is the part you might have been waiting for. The Who's first American tour, August 23rd, 1967. They're opening for Herman's Hermits. They're like, Herman's Hermits. It's funny, the Who's opening for Herman's Hermits. Herman's Hermits. Herman and his Hermits. They had songs like, I am Henry the Eighth, I am, I'm Henry the Eighth, I am, I am.
Yeah.
And then,
so they're
can't you hear my heartbeat? Can't you hear my heartbeat? Yeah, you know, they're kind of popping. And then the Who opened for them at Atwood Stadium in Flint.
There it is. There it is.
We're both born and raised in and around Flint.
Atwood Stadium's still there.
Yeah, no, it is. It's a sports field for one of the local high schools now, I think that.
Yeah, and they keep, you know, kind of putting a little bit of money into it.
Yeah, it's a nice field. I mean, for back in the day, just the neighborhood around it. It's getting better, though. I mean,
that neighborhood is coming around a little bit. It is, because it's got the colleges and, exactly. And that new, you know, shoving the whole thing, they pre-plowed it over.
Just the most brief synopsis of you and I. Flint was a big auto town when we were growing up in Michigan. It's actually considered Vehicle City, Detroit's Motor City, Flint is Vehicle City, and everybody you knew, your uncle, your dad, your cousin, your mom, somebody worked for Flint or a company that supplied something to an auto factory.
Or for Buick or Delphi or GM in some way. Yeah.
Even like the paper factory that makes the paper that goes to the GM factories, whatever. So that was that was Flint, and so at this time, it was humming away, man, and Atwood Stadium was a big sort of stadium complex downtown.
Yeah, how many people? I bet it'd get like 15,000 people.
Oh, yeah, I would think so, 12, 15, probably somewhere in there.
Yeah. Who's the dad?
Oh, my God.
I can't say names?
No, you can't. You can't say names. I just looked
it up on Facebook the other day, too. So we're all hanging out, and now Luke and the couple guys that we hung out with in that little crowd, they're kind of guys in fifth grade would like break out of the house at night after spending the night at somebody's buddy's house.
Rough fifth graders.
Catholic school kids. Yeah. We go like teepee somebody's house. Yeah. But the best thing about Catholic school dudes is that you have to go to bed for like 3 hours and wake up and you're like, we're going to clean that shit up.
Yeah.
Nobody ever knew they had teepee.
It's true.
So anyways, Luke's dad. It's like a Saturday afternoon. We're out playing football, and he goes, yo, boys, you want to go play some football? Because he's from Chicago.
Because he's from Chicago, yeah. And that's how they talk.
This and that and the other.
Well, yeah. He was like a youth.
Whatever.
Something.
Minister.
No, like a corrections officer.
Yeah. He was.
This kid was like one of the worst ones.
He sometimes worked in the jail. He sometimes lived in the jail.
Correct.
So he loads us up in his old DC cab, like me and David. I can't say his last name, can I?
No, just
me and David, me and David. Jeff, and Luke.
Right. That's a great story. Why do you
need
last
to say David? Oh, so we all go to...
Sidebar, we had a conversation with my wife and some other...
This is sidebar to sidebar.
Right, women of her age.
And she's like, what's with men always telling stories with the guy's full name? Like, what is that? Why do you guys have to list his full name? And I figured it out. I said, it adds to the credibility of the story if I cite the entire reference. As opposed to just, Tommy said.
I think it's because, for you and I, it's because Mr. Ford.
Because he said everyone's full name?
No, he never used your first name. It was like,
oh, Mr. So-and-so.
RuPaul?
Yeah, I've always been a last
RuPaul.
Name.
Mr. Kingsley.
I've been a last name since.
You're out of here.
You're right. I have been a last name since like fourth or
Mr.
fifth grade.
Ford. Yeah, so.
Yeah, you're right.
Anyways, Luke's dad loads us all up in the car, and we don't know where we're going. So we drive down this like sketch part of Flint, parked down by the river, on this dead-end road. There's like some garbage and shit, and there's like a fence.
Like, what are we doing?
He's like, come on, guys, get out. So we sneak into Atwood Stadium, the back part of the stadium, because somebody, like, cut the fence. Now, Atwood Stadium, the front of it's all, like, nice brick.
Beautiful brickwork.
Yeah, with, like, nice entrances with turnstiles and everything, and their pick booths and everything. And it says Atwood Stadium on the front when you're driving by it. You can definitely see it. It's almost like the big house, but smaller.
It's a small big house.
I got a new instrument, bro. It's a spring on the mic stand.
No, leave the boom stand alone.
So, anyways, we sneak into the back of that. Because Luke's dad saw us playing football like in the yard. He's like, not good enough. We're going to Atwood Stadium.
So, you played football.
Oh, we threw the football around in Atwood Stadium.
So, you played football at Atwood Stadium.
I did not know the who were that. I did not know that. I thought it maybe was the IMA Sports Arena.
Wow. No. Now called Pirani Arena. I don't think that existed. They might have played at Auto World. You guys want a fun history lesson about Flint? Look up Auto World.
Wait.
Super tangent. So, The Who's first American tour, 1967, Atwood Stadium, opening for Herman's Hermits, said it's going to be Keith's 21st birthday. It wasn't. It was his 20th birthday, but he wanted to drink in the United States.
So it is life.
It's his 21st birthday.
Make it till you make it.
They jam out Atwood Stadium. They rock that place out, right?
Sound like this, everybody.
Everybody.
Oh, Brian, you take this.
The concert wraps up about 10 o'clock. I don't know. 1967. I don't know. The band and the entourage return to the motel. The Holiday Inn. It's basically on Bristol and Atherton.
What? Oh. Hold on, where?
Like, all right, you're coming down 75 towards the airport.
Yeah.
You get off on Bristol, and you take that loop. There's the GM shops to the left.
Yeah.
And then there's, like, a Total gas station, and, like, there's still, like, a travel lodge or something right there on the right.
Okay.
Used to be a Holiday Inn right there at the corner.
Okay. Bristol?
Like, Bristol and Atherton, kind of like that way.
I thought Bristol and Atherton
run the same direction. What's the other road then? Bristol and it's the one that Hammerburg turns into when you come up by the GM shops. And then Bristol turns to. No, it's farther east than that. All
right. We're going to find.
It's 2207 West Bristol Road for those of you in Flint. In the line.
Hey, Siri, look up 2207.
West Bristol.
West Bristol Road. She's not great. She's high. All right, go ahead.
Well, everybody in the road crew were partying hard, and the pool had so much spilled booze in it, they actually christened it the world's largest martini. So the day goes on, more and more people, more and more booze. There's naked people with fire extinguishers shooting around the pool.
I like this party.
It's a good party. Five-tier birthday cake supplied by Premier Drums with a girl inside shows up. And Keith throws handfuls of cake at anybody you can see. And a food spike. This is the
girl popped out of the cake?
Oh, yeah.
That really happened?
Yeah. Well,
I always thought that was just like a thing they did on TV.
Allegedly, that happened. So, no, that happened. So, he's throwing giant cake at anybody who comes in. And now, they were like in a room, like a banquet room, like a dining room. It's spread out into the lobby.
This is at the hotel.
This is at the hotel. On this.
On his 20th birthday.
Yes. 21st, wink, wink, U.S.
Right.
Toilets were exploded, of course.
Of course, yeah.
And then Keith misplaces his clothes, so he's running around naked. A piano gets destroyed. Objects and people are being thrown into the pool, right? So this party is fucking, like,
a party.
This is full balls, man. This is all out, dude. This is a party for Flint. So the police arrive with guns drawn, and a naked Keith streaks off.
Don't look, Ethel. And he jumps into a Lincoln Continental. Where would you keep your keys if you were keyed and you were naked?
Well, I mean, I think, was it his car?
Not the point. Didn't have keys, and so he pulls the parking brake, and then the car slowly rolls backwards into the pool.
Oh, really?
Correct.
Oh, I just thought he drove the motherfucker into the pool.
No. He didn't have keys. That's what I was going to say. Where'd you keep the keys?
Well, my keys were in the vehicle.
Fastest thing on 2 feet. There's an audience to be found. He'll be streaking it round, inviting public critique. Oh, name the artist. So basically, Keith sitting in the Lincoln Continental naked in the pool, sinking to the bottom.
Probably laughing his ass
off. He was. There's some articles. I don't have the quotes, but he remembers himself just like being very calm and like, well, I can't wait. I have to wait till the pressure equalizes. And he's like, I remembered me physics, you know, shit like that. So. Naked Keith swims up to the top.
Yeah, but he had then they didn't have power window, so he could just, roll the window.
Yeah, crank the window down. Naked Keith swims up to the top, slips away from the cops because they're waiting for him, but he's naked and getting out of the pool.
He got away from the cops?
Yeah, well, because he's drunk, naked, and wet, and fleeing the police, he slips on some of the cake he threw earlier, and he busts his front tooth out.
Oh!
And so then the cops get him, and then they escort him to a dentist before they take him to jail. And I didn't look super hard, but I am curious at who is that dentist in Flint who worked on Keith Moon?
Yeah.
Right. If you know, drop us a line on Twitter, Facebook, or Instagram, man. That would be kind of neat. So, the dentist.
Whatever his last name was, Crentist.
Keith was so drunk.
How drunk was he?
Nice. He didn't require Novocaine for his dental surgery. Keith spent the night in jail, and then they chartered a plane to get him to Philadelphia to meet the rest of the band. And Herman's Hermits manager, Ed McCann, paid the hotel bill of $24,000.
That's all it was?
Today's money, that would be $179,835.41.
That's better.
So
that's better.
The record company apparently...
That's a great story.
We're not done.
No, the Flint story.
Oh, yeah,
just the Flint story.
That's funny.
We had, Flint was never Detroit. It was never New York or whatever.
No. It was a smaller metropolitan.
But, dude, we've had a couple good stories, and that's one of my, tiny little favorite Flint stories.
That's great.
Yeah.
Well, the record company apparently bought the damp car off of whoever owned it.
The what?
The record company.
Damp car?
Moist. Moist car off of whoever owned it, whoever owned the moist car.
Whoever.
The Who were permanently banned from Flint, Michigan. You'll never see them in Flint.
I bet they'd let them back.
Holiday Inn declared the first global lifetime ban of The Who, so they're not allowed
Holiday Inn.
Holiday Inns globally.
They're really going after these kids.
Hotel operators now promote celebrities leaving their hotel as opposed to hey, guess who's coming to stay with us?
Because of them?
Correct. They say, guess who stayed with us? And
don't fork.
This is my favorite. Hotel architects now make it considerably more difficult for motor vehicles to interact with the swimming pools.
So, worded very nicely. Interact.
There were more things too, road managers now keep so much more cash on hand for offstage antics, and then insurance companies have to have such a higher.
And this is attributed to the Who and Keith Moon.
And Keith Moon. So there's all sorts of new things, like tour managers and stuff. Oh, God, he did.
And he didn't really get in trouble for it.
No, Moon the Loon, he was very eccentric, and people liked him. He liked being known as Mr. Funny. That was, kind of his thing. It's he wanted people to laugh at him. That's his whole bit. He was in a limo one time on the way to LAX Airport. Keith was like, oh, yeah, wait, oh, yeah, I forgot something. And that was Ozzy Osbourne. I don't know what he was doing there. Keith was like, hey, wait, I forgot something. And they went back to the hotel, right? The limo pulls back. He goes up to the room, and then they just see him shove the TV out of the window into the pool. And then he comes back down. He gets back in the limo, and he goes, nearly forgot that.
Drove off. Wait, make everybody go out of your way because you got one little whim.
These are the people,
driver.
And this is the guy who basically started trashing hotel rooms. This is it. This is the genesis for all of it. No one did that shit before him. This
and
is
he just
the guy.
Shit.
and he just wrecked.
Well, he said that they also were the first ones. They just, like, wrecked guitars.
Yeah, he broke it accidentally, and then the crowd's like, yeah, smash it. And he's like, and then as soon as Keith is like, yeah, like, let's do this.
I can get paid to wreck things. Put me down.
Right. Keith, he became a regular at some London clubs, Bag of Nails and the Speakeasy.
Like a regular performer?
Just a regular hanger-outer, like a barfly. And remember the Speakeasy? That was in the Sid Vicious episode.
Yeah,
apparently. It's a big club in London.
Oh, I thought it was in Flushing.
Yeah, well, it's in Flushing, England. It's out there.
Well, don't you remember the Speakeasy in Flushing?
I do remember the Speakeasy. It turned into a tiki bar, which I think is now something else.
Yeah.
He spent a lot of cash on booze and drugs, and kind of all this eccentric behavior was sort of fueled by the drugs and alcohol. I mean, he would have been nuts, but I don't think he would have been as nuts, they're saying.
That's a chicken egg thing.
Yeah, could be.
Was he crazy because of the drugs, or was he...
he's a little crazy
because he's crazy. I mean, whatever.
August 1969. The Who play Woodstock.
Yeah.
They hated every second of it.
It was kind of nasty weather, wasn't it?
It was bad weather. They went on 16 hours late. The concert was behind schedule. They had some freaks. Honestly, I want to say something like, I don't remember who it was, but one of the bands got all tripped out and, like, wouldn't get off stage for hours and hours.
I guess it's called the Grateful Dead.
Set them all behind. Yeah, maybe. Also, their drinks were spiked with LSD before they went on stage. They did not want to do that. It was sort of done to them. And then photographers wouldn't leave them alone. They're just, like, harassing them constantly.
Woodstock was special.
Oh,
it can never be done again.
They did it in 1994.
Not even close.
If you don't know.
Are you talking the one that with the Green Day? Was that?
Yeah, Mudstock. If you're unaware, Woodstock was a huge rock festival.
No,
festival.
Fuck you if you don't know it.
You shouldn't know this. You don't know Woodstock.
You don't know what Woodstock is,
turn it off. No. Don't turn it off. Don't turn this off. Dawn breaks, Woodstock, The Who's on stage, they jam out Tommy, rock opera, people love it.
At dawn.
Yeah. So, they hated Woodstock, but they killed it. People, you know, more.
Well, they're one of the bands that came out of Woodstock, more pop. Like, that was a, right. They were popular before, it sounds like.
Same thing, yeah.
And I'm not real familiar with their timeline of popularity, but.
It goes very quickly.
There were some bands that went into Woodstock. Nothing and came out legends.
Carlos Santana.
Yeah.
Also got spiked with LSD. He'd never done LSD before, and he's like, dude, I had like 12 fingers, man. He's like, I don't know, he's playing guitar. So he killed it too.
Oh, and that there is a baseball player. I believe it's a pitcher.
He pitch on LSD?
A no hitter.
Oh God. Wow.
Yeah. I'm gonna look that up. But he pitched one of the best baseball games ever. And it's crime. It's legit. He was at LSD.
I'm going to start conspiracy theory talk and get my tinfoil hat on, but they always talk about the U.S. government doing tests on LSD for, like, special forces people and stuff just to, like, keep them awake or
get them over the hump.
Yeah, something like that. And it's just like, wow, is that... But now you hear more and more of these stories like that.
What was that movie, Men Who Talk to Goats?
To Goats, yeah. People, I don't know, man. People must get in the zone. I have never done LSD, and I don't want to.
No, I'm scared of it.
Yep.
I'm scared of everything.
That's synthetic.
I don't know if I'm scared of it, I don't think it should be.
That would probably be a bad trip. Keith doesn't always do LSD. In 1972, Keith was consuming 2 bottles of champagne and 2 bottles of brandy a day.
The champagne's no big deal. Brandy's a little more potent.
2 of those, man, you have 2 and 2. So, one time at the home of a guitarist, as our first guitarist, Leslie West, Keith sees a line of cocaine on the table, and he snorts that thing all up.
That was the beginning of a good thing. That was a beautiful friendship.
Well, it wasn't cocaine. It was heroin for the whole thing.
So that was a whole entire 8-ball that you just did on the heroin.
He snorted a potentially lethal dose of heroin, so they take him to the hospital, they pump his stomach, and they give him a shot of adrenaline right to the heart.
Pump his stomach? I mean, in your stomach, man.
No, that is not in your stomach. So
he's probably drunk, too, though.
Oh, yeah. Get
everything possibly can.
So in 1973, Kim divorces Keith. They had a bad marriage because he keeps drinking and partying and stuff. And he This is the line I found. He'd broken her nose no less than 3 times.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
He was hitting her?
Yeah, she'd pack up and leave, and then Keith would be like, come on back, and she would go back. But she finally divorced him, 1973.
Right, good for her.
Yeah, yes.
And kind of scared this whole entire Keith Green guy.
Well, while leaving a bar one time at closing time, Keith Moon and others were being intimidated by some young skinheads. Alright, so, they weren't old skinheads, they were young skinheads. So Keith's chauffeur, Neil Boland, hops in Keith's Bentley, and drives Keith and the others away, but some skinheads kind of, like, block the path. And so Neil gets out of the car to try and disperse the skinheads. And then Keith jumps behind the wheel, and then somehow Boland fell into the car, and Keith drove over him.
Ooh,
yeah, he's dead. Keith is absolved of the guilt, and some skinheads get fined for starting a confrontation.
I got one right there, anyway.
You did,
yeah.
But you won. You won the race. Ben and our friend Matt. See, I can say stories without using last names. Ben and Matt were racing home from our local bar. And
we
Ben won.
No. No, it was not a bar. It was at Scott's house.
Oh, well, that's...
And we're getting ready to go...
To the bar.
No, we were no... There's no alcohol involved. This is before we drank, dude. I swear to God, it was.
We were in eighth grade? What is this?
No, we never... I never really drank until, like, senior year in high school.
Well, you made up for it now.
Oh, we made up for it. But we were, like, 16, and we're like, hey, let's go to the grocery store. We got to go get some, like, snacks. I still want snacks. Seriously. And so we wanted to get some snacks, but we don't want to take two cars. But we're leaving Scott's house. We each had a vehicle at Scott's. So we're like, yo, let's ride to Matt's house. And Matt, I drove separate his car, Caprice Classic 1976.
This sounds like some Bieber and Khalil shit right here.
No, we weren't racing.
Racing.
No, Grandpa Matt didn't race.
That's true.
Grandpa Matt did not race.
That's true.
And so we left, and I get to Matt's house, and I knew I was going to, I mean, it was like 7 miles down the road. And I'm...
Ben won.
I won.
I win.
I'm here first. Woo. So I pull into Matt's house. I'm like on a cul-de-sac.
How would you celebrate?
Well, I was waiting for Matt because I just want to hop in his car. We'll go to the grocery store and get snacks. I think we're getting ready to go camping or hunting or something. I don't know. We're just going to go. We just had to go to the Myers.
I laugh because I know what's going to happen.
So I'm standing there because I didn't want to. We didn't even go in the house. Well, his mom and dad are home, and they were kind of some older people. And so I'm just like, I don't want to deal with them people. And
I'll just wait outside.
I just waited outside. I just was like standing on the porch. I'm like, where's the motherfucker at?
This is so boring waiting for Matt.
So it's kind of boring listening to you right now, but I'm going to tell the whole story. So then I go stand down on the driveway. I'm like, he's just going to pull in. I'm going to hop in. We're going to go. A couple minutes go by. I'm like, where in the hell? There's no stoplights either. That's the thing. This was like all country roads. And so we get to, I sit down in the driveway because I'm that lazy. Can't stand for 10 minutes. No Matt.
There's like two turns from Scott's house to Matt's house.
Yeah.
I was just thinking about it. I'm like, wait a minute.
It's like 7 miles away, 55 mile an hour
on our back roads. Yeah.
So I know Link knows Grandpa Matt. Matt drove. He still drives so slow. I mean, he's all over the road, too. Whatever. So,
I wonder what it's like to be the ring man.
So, I'm now
inside.
For whatever reason, not the best decision in my life, laying down in the driveway.
Just chilling back, waiting for Matt.
Just laying down, hands behind. Just like,
in his driveway.
Where's this dude?
Next to your car.
He comes barreling through the subdivision.
Up the driveway.
Around the cul-de-sac, in the circle. And I'm just looking around like, he should be waiting for me in the road. Why is he not here? He must have went in the house. And so he's got his head on a pivot looking around, other than where he's driving, where I'm at. And he drives right over me.
Pulls right up on top of Ben.
I spin
around. Folds his legs up over his head.
Yeah,
his
he
face.
Comes like straight up over me. So I'm laying down. He comes like right up over my knee, my waist. And of course, natural reaction. I like try to grab the bumper. I'm trying to put my feet up to stop because I want to stop the car. It's 1977, 76 Caprice Classic. It's a big, mofo car.
Hercules, Hercules, Hercules.
So I get twisted.
Adrenaline gets bent, and he gets twisted. And
I get twisted under the car, like 90 degrees. Oh. So my head, counterclockwise, rotates underneath the car. The tire goes over my chest. I remember that very, very vividly. The tire. And I thought,
huh, that was not bad.
I didn't die. No. The tire didn't hurt.
I'm really.
Now I'm pinned under the car. My knees are up by my knees are up by my ears.
I totally remember what happens now.
And Matt, and he knows I'm yelling, I'm screaming. I'm like a tiny little baby.
Get off me.
He opens the door, looks down, and there's my head. Like looking right back at him, yelling.
Lift up the car!
Lift up the car. I'm thinking Matt's got this super strength, now this human, superhuman, like you don't hear the story about the TV falling on the infant.
The mom just superhuman mom going up a truck.
And so Matt gets like, he's freaking out, I'm freaking out, everybody's freaking out, there's yelling going on. And he and his dude, he's like, okay, I'm going to lift up this car.
I'm going to lift this car.
Lines up that rocker board.
Yep.
No, that doesn't happen.
It's a Caprice Classic, baby.
1976.
That ain't going nowhere.
So he left. He actually got a little bit of tension, like, off the springs, you know, kind of just.
Oh, sure. Yeah, flex
and so
out
I was
shocks.
Able to push my feet out straight.
Oh, God. That so must have been relief.
It was. And I started, like, giggling because I was happy because I could feel my toes. I was so happy. I thought I was going to die. Or,
oh,
or
God. Eyes. Yeah, paralyzed.
Whatever. So that game, Matt, he got the jack out and lifted up the car. And we hobbled into his mom and dad's house.
His mother is a nurse.
His mother's a nurse, but his mother was also not on the clock at that point.
Nurses will not help you.
So his dad.
No offense, nurses.
So
my mother-in-law's a nurse.
His dad Rick's on the phone with Uncle David, and we walk in and we're like just sputtering things and what the hell? My kids are right now. And then his mom's watching Jeopardy on the couch, and
Mom, I just ran Ben over with the car.
And she just kind of, like, does a, like, turns her head a 180, looks at me, goes right back to fucking Jeopardy. Like, we're yelling, we're screaming, we're loud, I'm bleeding, pants are ripped, I'm hanging off things. Neither of these people believe anything we have to say.
No, yeah. Matt's, like, a foot shorter than you.
And perspective. I don't know what the kids are, I gotta call you Matt, Dave. What the hell's going on?
Oh, my God.
There you go, Matt.
I don't know if it's been Rupert.
Lesson.
All right, now Matt's I'll leave in because he's not gonna sue us.
Matt, motherfucker.
Now I'm gonna have to bleep it out.
Why?
I don't know. Get him to sign a release.
All right, we got Keith Moon stuff.
Good story, but
Keith Moon.
So imagine that, but you didn't live. That's what happened to Keith Moon. Because later he was killed again.
He didn't die like that.
No, Keith Moon didn't. The guy did, though. Neil Borland is dead.
Borland?
Yeah, Keith ran him over with his Bentley.
Not gonna work anymore, anyway.
Yeah. September 6th, 1978. Keith and his girlfriend, she's a Swedish supermodel.
That's a Madison joke, by the way, everybody.
It's a Swedish, if you have to explain it. It's a Swedish supermodel girlfriend, Annette Walter Lacks. They go to a dinner with Paul and Linda McCartney.
Oh.
Paul McCartney and his wife is having a film preview party for the Buddy Holly story.
Does she still have two legs?
Yeah, at this time she did. And it's the Buddy Holly story with Gary Busey! Ah, I'm Gary Busey!
Dude. I'll do a story. Did he sing anything?
Buddy Holly. He was Buddy Holly.
Can we do a Gary Busey episode?
I will totally do a Gary Busey episode.
Even if it's a mini episode, I want to hear the story in its entirety about him doing cocaine and off the dog.
Okay.
Like, he spilled a whole entire bag of cocaine on a dog, and then he, like, shook out the dog,
and then did it. This is beautiful, because Keith originally did not want to go to this party with Paul McCartney and Linda, and then he called and got a bag of cocaine, and Bob's your uncle, he went to the Buddy Holly story. So, he took his Swedish supermodel, well, not supermodel, I didn't mean to demote her. His Swedish model girlfriend. She might be a supermodel.
Why did you say supermodel?
Because it didn't exist back then. It was 1978.
Oh, so when did this start?
I want to say Kathy Ireland or what's her name? The Mole.
Cindy Crawford.
Oh, she's so pretty. She's like in her 60s and she's gorgeous. My God.
Is she still gorgeous?
Uh-huh.
and her kid, her daughter, looks exactly like her.
Yo, you all know I saw it. Oh. I saw Pat Benatar's daughter.
Oh. Nice, yeah. All right. Well, there you go. Yeah. Interesting. Who did Pat Benatar get with?
I don't know. He must have had a nice big butt.
A good-looking fellow with a large ass.
I like it.
Yeah. So they're at this party at the Peppermint Park. It's a restaurant and with Paul and Linda. And Keith and Annette are like, I'm bored. Let's go home. So they go home.
Oh, that's a great story, bro.
Keith... Keith asks Annette to make him some steak and eggs, and she objects. And Keith says, if you don't like it, then you fuck off.
More Brian.
Am I British accent?
Yeah, the British accent.
If you don't like it, you can fuck off.
It sounds like a bad Simpsons character.
That's the best. That's what I was raised on. If you don't like it, you can fuck off.
You cunt?
He's a good cunt. Those were Keith's last words.
Oh, really? Oh, wow. Is there a specific date and time here we have coming up, Brian?
That was September 7th, 1978.
All right.
Police determined that there were 32 clomethiazole pills. It's a prescribed drug that helps people get off alcohol and insomnia. So it's kind of like a chill, like a sedative.
Like a Xanny?
Kind of, but clomethiazole.
Clomethiazole.
I said it. That was awesome.
So he did a bunch of them?
32 clomethiazole pills. Six were digested. 26 were not when he died.
He did. I mean, he must have done. If six killed him.
Yeah. Keith Moon, 32.
He probably knew he was doing that.
Was dead. He was in excess of everything. I mean, there's things like where him and Jim Morrison were backstage at concerts, and they would literally both take a handful of pills off a table, not knowing what they are, and swallow them, and then look at each other and go, and then that was like,
did it well for both of them now,
so,
didn't it?
Right. And then, oh, unfortunately, he was in the same apartment that Mama Cass was in when she OD'd and died. If she OD'd, I don't know if she OD'd. She died.
Yeah, she died. Choked on a ham sandwich.
Whatever. So she died.
Wow. Why is that a thing? Why do people think Mama Cass
so mean
died on a ham sandwich?
Yeah, you're right.
Why? I don't know.
But they lived in the same apartment, and when, Pete Townsend and Keith Moon were looking at the apartment. They were like, people are like, this is cursed, Keith. Don't buy it. It's like, it's cursed. And then Pete goes, no, man. Lightning could not possibly strike twice the same place. It's not about it. You buy
that was Mama Cass's apartment?
Yeah. So he
wow.
Died. Yeah. She died at 32 also.
Wow.
So Moon was cremated September 13th, 1978 in London. His ashes were scattered at the Golden Greens Gardens of Remembrance.
32.
I like this quote from Alice Cooper, who is a famous American goth rocker, as it said in Wikipedia. Alice Cooper.
A famous American goth rocker. You know what's cool about Alice Cooper?
Makes a hell of a hot dog.
That's an act.
Oh, yeah.
That's his act. Right. But he's not above saying that.
Right.
It's his act.
The one that gets me is Larry the Cable Guy. That's an act.
That's an act.
That motherfucker went to Cornell.
And he, if you look at his early stuff, none of it.
No.
No.
It was like,
but he's selling it.
Yeah. And he sells out still. 50,000 seats, dude, in the Midwest.
Yeah. But Alice Cooper, at least, is like, that's my name. I get a wife here. I don't always wear makeup.
Cooper's is a sweet restaurant somewhere.
You said hot dog?
Yeah, he does some huge footlong hot dog. Guy Fieri was talking about it. So, Alice Cooper, about Keith Moon, quote, nobody could cook. Jesus. Sorry. let's try it now. And I wonder if I won't edit that.
You better not.
I work for that.
Probably too lazy to do it. So.
Alice Cooper quote on Keith Moon. Quote, nobody could compete with Keith Moon. Think about it this way. About 40% of what you hear about me or Iggy or Ozzy is probably true. Everything you've heard about Keith Moon is true, and you've only heard about 10% of it.
So he was off the road. He was full bore.
Sounds like he was full bore.
He was Keith Moon. I like that Flint story. I mean, that's a legend around here.
Yeah, it is.
I feel like
Flint. Like around Flint. Yeah. Drives a car into the pool.
Now, they claimed it didn't happen, but the guy, McCann, the manager for Herman's Hermits, is like, damn well did. I paid the fee. You know, like, yeah. I guarantee we paid for it. I guarantee that happened.
You know, I think I've heard it both ways.
So, right.
But, my dad grew up in Flint. Your dad, all of our family, my dad grew up in Flint.
Yeah.
It was a beautiful place back. I mean, today it's kind of like, I'm from Flint, man. But no, back then I was
right. My mom grew up in the nice part of Flint.
Yeah.
Like, and back in the day, which was like.
I think my dad was, you know, he went to a lot of concerts, a lot of stuff. They had a lot of different things at like Atwood and a bunch of little.
Yeah, that would be sweet.
And some bars and stuff. And, you know, they hung out with Grand Funk Railroad and
Grand Funk,
the Bob Seger down here in Ann Arbor. I mean, that's where Rob's from. So, you know, he was part of that scene. So he tells a story. And he's got a lot of Who albums. So he was. Probably about the same age as them.
Yeah, probably.
It was a couple years. You know, he was telling me stories about it back then, and we all heard stories about it. So that was a fun story.
That's a good one, man.
Because it doesn't sound like Keith Moon was out to hurt people.
No, he was just a crazy.
He was a kind, like not kind-hearted.
No,
he was a jokester.
He had some problems with people. He just always wanted people to laugh and have fun.
Yeah, he was
hurt.
I mean, I'll be a guy. That's all he can
say. He punched his wife in the face three times.
Yeah, like broke her nose. That was not good.
He named Led Zeppelin. Did you know that?
No.
He was sort of dicking around like an early version of the guys in Zeppelin. And he's sitting there and he just looks at him and he goes, it's going to fall like a Led Zeppelin. And then he went off to the Who and they're like, pretty good name.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
And that's fun hearing about these old rock. I mean, we grew up.
We didn't even get into his drumming, man. That dude changed, like, what drums were. People used to just sort of kick back, like, two and four. And Keith Moon was like, you know, like, he just went apeshit, man. Just unleashed, had a huge drum set, like 360 degrees, kind of like the first Neil Peart sort of guy. And so
second Rush reference.
So I didn't get into all that, but he literally changed, like, how rock and roll drumming was done, you know?
Yeah.
Like, it used to be way more laid back, and he brought it to the front, and so.
Well, that was rock and roll. That was the beginning. I mean, that was.
The Who did carry on without him. They got a guy named Kenny Jones from Faces. There's an English band called Faces. Now, Kenny Jones is really good, and they're like, this is about pretty much the only guy who could replace Keith Moon. But
now,
it's a different sound, they say. It's not quite as hyper and raw and all that stuff.
Who was the dude? Was it Daltrey? That kind of had a little bit of a.
That's the singer? Or no?
Little boy fetish thing?
That was the guy from Queen.
No. No.
No, I cannot comment. I did not find
out. No, there was something. I don't know which one of the other pop. It was.
Who was the other one? Well, there's Daltrey, there's Pete Townsend, there's John Entwistle.
No, we're going to go maybe Townsend. What are the two? I don't know.
Townsend?
Well, they found some, like, bad shit on his computer or something. And he's like, no, I was just researching it. You know, I was just researching it because it's wrong, and I want to do a paper. I'm going to write a paper on how wrong it is. Got away with it.
Is that payola?
I'm not gay. I have sex with men so I can prove to myself I don't like it.
Do not like this.
What?
This no, story? Like, I just, no, I was just thinking, like, oh, in the moment, you're just like, nope, I can pretty much tell you,
I
don't like
this. Once a month, I prove myself, I don't like it.
I don't like this.
I don't
this.
Like
okay.
Being on the top or the bottom.
Well, we should try both sides.
Yeah, yeah.
Now you know.
Yeah, that's where all the power is generated.
I don't even know what that means. That's awesome. Well, since we said power bottom, that's the end of the show. We don't.
We're not gonna
we don't have any feedback to listen to this week, so we're not gonna do that. No, leave us feedback on the social medias, guys. Go to our website, leave us a SpeakPipe.
I want everybody to do that. I'm gonna like get drunk and yell at you
on SpeakPipe?
Yeah, I'm gonna yell at you about that.
That'll be great. Well, if you wanna do that, go to our website, www.com. Find music, it's in there somewhere, and go to the part where it says SpeakPipe. And all you gotta do is push the button, and it'll use the microphone on your phone, your cell tablet, and then leave us a voicemail message. And then if it's cool and we like it, and you don't say too mean of things, or if you say something super mean, we'll put you on the next episode.
I'm gonna say something really, really mean.
Tell us how you really feel.
Seriously.
Please
be interesting.
Well, that's our job. They don't have drum set by the back.
Don't worry.